This is Kevin, B-roll, scene one, take two.
See, Gazebo is an open source 3D robotics simulator.
I'm not sure if I should say that it's integrated with ROS, because it's kind of its own thing.
We've done demos at shows where kids try it out and they say, that was really cool, but you really need to work on your graphics, and then we say, but we got the physics right. It's this really careful system that simulates this very complex environment and then also has all of this autonomous code running in it. But that's not what they see.
It looks just like a video game. It's a 3D world with objects and there is a robot moving there. The difference from a video game is that the physics is very realistic and it is receiving the same controls that you would send to a real robot. So it's really simulating the real world, unlike a video game that may have some special effects and some physics shortcuts, but it's just like a video game where the robots live.
Oh, they have fire pits here now. So it was this great time when an intern showed up and he was here before anyone else was in the office, but he still had Wi-Fi connection. So he was able to log into the PR2 and teleop it to open the door for him. And so he was able to, you know, get in the office without actually having a key or badge because he left it at home. That could be the first, you know, use case for home robotics, right? Everyone's trying to get into the home robotics space. What you really need is just a robot to turn off the gas on your stove, open the door for you, put away the groceries.
Nate came to Willow as an intern. He was the perpetual intern, actually. I think he was the longest intern at Willow Garage before he became full-time.
I don't know why he got assigned to me, because he knew more than I did. And I remember asking him when I interviewed, like, you know, what's your kind of schedule? Or, you know, do you roll in at 10? Because that's how most of us are. And he's like, no, I start work at 6. AM.
As part of his like time in his PhD, he created Gazebo. And so he kind of brought Gazebo into the fold at Willow and provided the ROS bindings for it to work well with ROS.
So suddenly we had a simulation component because Nate was there, right? And he contributed and made it work seamlessly with ROS.
It had always been a passion of mine, and I never really thought it would go anywhere, but it was great to have funding, backing, and other people that found it useful. So that was cool and scary because now people need to use it and want to use it, so it has to work.
In the early days at Willow, we had a real scarcity of hardware. I remember that first summer when we had, I think, 20 interns show up, and there were maybe 2.5 robots. And so having a good simulation environment allows you to have potentially everybody with a computer be able to test what they're doing all the time without needing access to either the physical hardware, which might be scarce or fragile or expensive, as well as the physical environment in which to test it.
People who are just learning robotics, they need physical robots. They become a lot more excited and inspired by physical robots. But once you have conquered that, simulation then becomes like your next toolkit because you want to work on more expensive or more complicated robots, and those are harder to get.
I think the problem is that in simulation, you can get almost anything to work. When you see a robot do something in simulation, you're obligated to ask, okay, but does this actually work in reality?
It's going to adjust and try and follow the wall right now. When you've written something and you get it out there running and it actually does something, it doesn't do something reasonable on the first try, but it takes time to improve it and get it to do what you want it to do. So we are in my kitchen in Newbury Park, California, and this is where I do most of my robotics challenge work. When my kids were little, I was really busy with them, but as they started going to preschool and school, I had more time to do things outside of just
being a dad. And so I've been doing robotics challenges to continue learning about coding and robotics, and it's been an enjoyable way to learn.
The Space Robotics Challenge came our way in early 2017. So Valkyrie is a humanoid robot developed by NASA. The goal of Valkyrie is to assist humans in space endeavors. So in the DARPA Robotics Challenge, there was a set of canned tasks, and each task would operate independently. And we were a little bit nervous that we made it too hard.
The first task that the robot had to complete was that a satellite dish was knocked out of alignment by the storm. And so the Valkyrie robot had to walk up to the dish and then use its hands or other appendages to adjust the dish to point back at the Earth so that the robot could see what it needed to do. The next task was that the power generation was damaged. So Valkyrie had to grab a solar panel, move it over to a table, open it up, and then connect it to the main array. And so that involved, again, both walking and manipulation by the robot.
So the Space Robotics Challenge was won by Team Coordinated Robotics, a single-person team run by Kevin Knadler.
And that was amazing, especially coming from, like, my experience with robotics challenges had been around the DARPA Robotics Challenge, where, you know, you had teams of 20, 30 people or even more who were all working together just to get a robot to do these really seemingly simple tasks. Earlier I'd worked with groups of people, but this particular time I was coaching two Odyssey of the Mind teams, two soccer teams, helping at school, and I wasn't sure. You need to really be able to work with people to be able to coordinate it, and so I decided just to go for this on my own.
So having Kevin come in and say, yeah, I can get this robot to do all this stuff by myself was pretty amazing.
He has a progression, and if he keeps this up, it'll be like a job. He's making enough money to actually count as a full-time job.
After the Space Robotics Challenge, I had the opportunity to run my code from the Space Robotics Challenge on the Valkyrie. I traveled out to New England, and on the first day I was there, I was able to run that code from the simulation on the Valkyrie robot and get the Valkyrie robot to actually complete one of the tasks. Normally, that takes weeks to get something up and running on a humanoid robot. You bash into things, fall over. It is lined up, and now it is turning the handles on the first day. And so that was a huge success. A lot of people were really happy to see that going from Gazebo to the real world in one day, man, it was a really good simulation and a really good tie-in between the two packages.
He went there, and in a couple of days, he adapted all of the code that he had done in simulation and ran it on the robot, and it just worked. And he had never seen the robot before. And I think this speaks about the power of simulation, right? Because you can really test your things in simulation and then transfer them to a physical robot much more easily.
It's kind of just rewarding and satisfying to see someone be this successful in a complex and challenging domain. Then you know you've done something right.
So many advances in robotics have come from the hardware and software that were developed at Willow Garage that I'm really not sure where robotics today would be if it hadn't been for Willow.
If Willow hadn't come along, we would not have a coherent global community around robot software.
Ross in particular has had a good accelerating impact on the industry. It's made it possible for people who couldn't play in this game to play, and that's important.
It is a very interesting and powerful model that I hope people in the future say, oh, that was good, let's try that again for some new discipline that we want to advance.
These days, the locus of energy is really in the commercial applications. And now we're seeing this explosion of robotics companies, and by and large, they're in some way or another using ROS.
Definitely the experience I had at Willow was foundational to being able to start a company, to having more insight into what space I should be caring about.
I think the core source of innovation at Willow Garage was that connection to the users. It was just so organic. And I knew when we started Zipline, I wanted to create the same thing.
Yeah, this is one of the highlights of my career, right? I'm hoping that, you know, Savio eclipses that for me, and then we get, you know, lots and lots of robots out in the world. But this was the thing that kind of brought everything I had learned and done together, and this was the chance to kind of really do something big for the world, and I'm really proud of it.